So what I love most about the Gold Lab Symposium is that it connects science with the real people behind the science. We get to see and meet the human side of our curiosity, challenges, and our successes. So when I heard that Sarah Gray would be speaking today, I was extremely excited because through her own experience with loss, Sarah not only made an extraordinary contribution to science through her son Thomas, she later pulled back the curtain that often separates us as scientists from the people we are trying to help, and us as people from the scientists working to solve our biggest problems. Her story reminds us of the connection between science and our humanity. And so when I took Sarah's mom last night to one of Boulder's finest plant shops to pull back the curtain of the chronic pain suffered here in Boulder, I was reminded that some moms are actually really cool and that the apple does not fall far from the tree. So with that in mind, the author of A Life Everlasting, Sarah Gray.
Is this on? Okay. Hello. Thank you for inviting me, Larry and Meredith. This is my first time here. It's a little bit overwhelming, but we're having a blast. Before I get started, I just want to do a little disclaimer that I'm going to be telling you just the normal, the truth of my life. These things actually happen, but it is hard to hear sometimes. So buckle your seatbelt. Trust me, it's going to get better, but there's some sad parts. So on September 30th, 2009, I was pregnant with twins, and I went to my first trimester screening, which is looking for birth defects. I think the most common one is Down syndrome. And I was 35 years old at the time, so I knew that I was at a higher risk for having a baby with a birth defect. So I did the normal Googling that you do, and I felt reasonably prepared for what I might hear. And I was shocked because the diagnosis that we heard was something I had never heard of in my life. You may be able to tell from the sonogram that these babies have different skulls. Baby A's skull is bumpy, and baby B's skull is round. So even though these twins were identical twins, genetically identical, the doctor explained that baby A had a fatal birth defect and would not survive the birth. He explained that the baby, basically the neural tube did not form all the way in the very early stages of development, and that meant that his skull wasn't completely closed. And as a result, the amniotic fluid was disintegrating his brain tissue. And he showed me that the amniotic sac was cloudy with the brain tissue, whereas baby B's sac was clear. The diagnosis is called anencephaly. Has anyone here heard of anencephaly before? Okay, yeah, this is a bunch of nerds, yeah, okay. this is the biggest crowd I've ever been in front of that has heard of anencephaly. but it means that the brain is not there, and the brain tissue that's there varies among the babies, so some babies have a lot of brain tissue and some have a little, and we wouldn't know until the baby came out. And essentially, when the twins were born and the cord was cut, that would begin the death of this child. My umbilical cord was keeping him alive. So as you can understand, this was shocking and devastating and not at all what we had expected to hear. I went online and did the Googling that everybody does, and I actually connected with some online communities and met some other people that had been through this diagnosis, even the diagnosis that I had with twins. And we looked into different studies that we could join. In fact, I learned about a study at Duke University that studies babies with anencephaly, their cord blood. And I started looking into organ, eye, and tissue donation. So my husband and I signed all the consent forms for organ, eye, and tissue donation, and we filled in all the paperwork for the Duke study as well. I learned through our local organ procurement organization called WRTC, Washington Regional Transplant Community, that our baby would likely be too small at birth to donate for transplant because they try to match the size of the organs from the donor to the recipient. And Thomas would just be so small at birth that there were no babies that small needing a transplant. However, he would be a candidate to donate for research. So we signed up for that. I'm happy to say that on March 23rd, 2010, the twins were born, and they were both born alive. This is a picture of Thomas, and here's a picture of both twins. So Thomas was born first, and a minute later, Callum was born. We were able to take Thomas home from the hospital. He actually lived for 6 days, so we got to get to know him a bit. And he seemed very much like a normal baby, aside from the way the doctor said that his skull would be, the top of his skull was missing. Aside from that, he would grip our fingers, and I breastfed him, and he drank from a bottle, and we were able to take him home. We had hospice care looking after him for the couple days that he was at home, and I was so grateful that they were there. This really wasn't part of my reality at all. I didn't even know what hospice care was. And I think maybe some euphemisms were used because I didn't catch on that this was an end-of-life nurse. I just thought it was a nurse that went to your house. And I was wondering, like, why do I go to the doctor? Like, why don't I just have nurses come to my house for my annual checkup or whatever? It really went over my head. But I was so grateful that we had a nurse there who was checking his heartbeat. And at the end of his life, I was able to call our whole family who was there. He died in my husband's arms, surrounded by everyone that loved him. He died really the way that I think everybody wants to die, which is surrounded by the people that love you. And I feel like we really couldn't have done any better as a way of sending him off. So the hospice nurse said, you know, do you want me to call WRTC? Their number's on my speed dial. And I said, yes, we've signed everything. So a van came to our home it was 2 a.m. and picked up his body and brought it to the nearest hospital, which was Children's National Medical Center in Washington, D.C. So my husband Ross and I went to sleep. We were so exhausted, our family left. And in the morning, we got a phone call from WRTC, my nurse Becky, and she said that the recovery had been a success and that they had recovered his eyes and his liver. And I had asked the nurses in the delivery to recover cord blood from both twins so that we could donate to Duke as well. So we learned that his liver went to a biotech firm called Cytonet in Durham. His corneas, which is the front of the eye, went to Harvard. And the back of his eye, the retina, went to Penn in Philadelphia. And then the cord blood went to Durham as well. So we had a funeral for Thomas, and we moved on the best that we could. I went back to work, and we had a beautiful, healthy boy to raise as well. So we just moved on, you know, the best we could. Of course, we're grieving like everybody in that situation. And we were even invited to grief counseling by WRTC. A lot of people don't know this, but the organ procurement organizations in a lot of your communities, wherever you live in the United States, there is an organ procurement organization that's dedicated to you and where you live. And a lot of times they offer free grief counseling to anyone in the community, no matter if you've donated or not. So we were invited to this and we attended. And this was something I had never really been through before. We were all seated in a circle, and we went around the room saying who we were and who we were grieving. And a lot of them said, my name is so-and-so. My husband recently died. We donated 2 kidneys and 2 lungs. And I even got letters from the people that received his organs to say thank you. And, you know, my husband saved 4 lives. And then the next person, my son died of an accidental gunshot wound. He's saved 8 people's lives, and we've received letters. And as everyone went around the circle, I was amazed that I didn't know that transplants were this common and that you could find out so quickly, like, wow, your loved one has saved these people. How satisfying is that to get that feedback right away? And so then when it got to my turn, I just was like, well, you know, my son died and he just died. Like, we donated to research, but I have really no idea what that means, if it was even worthwhile. But, you know, we feel like it was probably the right thing to do. And during the break, someone came up to me and they sort of were patting me on the shoulder, like, there, there, you know, research is important too. Like, you're never gonna know how many people your son has helped. And I'm kind of like, well, yeah, no shit. Like, I want to know, but I'm never going to know. And I feel really jealous of, you know, you people that donated for transplant, because you heard back. But whatever, I moved on. I asked WRTC at the one-year anniversary, can you give me any updates about what has happened? Did the researchers need these tissues? Have they discovered anything? Is anything going on? And they said, you know, we just don't do that. We never hear from the researchers. And I was like, okay, well, I tried, you know, and I learned, you know, my son, you know, I learned a little bit more detail about the Harvard study and things like that, and just kind of moved on. But then a year later, I went on a business trip to Boston, and I remembered that my son's corneas went to Boston. So I looked up how far the lab was from my hotel, and I saw it was only a couple miles away. And it started an accidental quest. So once I got to Boston, I had emailed the lab a couple times in advance to see if I could get a tour, but I didn't really hear back from anyone. So while I was there, it was like the day before we were supposed to leave, and I was like, it's now or never. If I'm going to get a tour, I'm not going to be back in Boston anytime soon. I've got to make a phone call and try one last time. But I'm also like, what's that going to do to my grief if they turn me down? Because I signed all the consent and all the informed consent saying, I understand that I have no right to any more information. I have no right. I give this anonymously. It's a donation. It's their property. It's not mine anymore. And I signed that fully informed. What's that going to feel like if she says, sorry, you know, thanks, but no thanks, you're not welcome here. But I took like all my courage I could muster, and I made the phone call, and I called the front desk, and I explained who I was. And the receptionist was caught off guard. And she said, we've never had a call like this before, but I'm going to find someone to help you, and don't hang up. So she connected me with someone in donor relations, which was financial donor relations, not organ donor relations. But she knew how to give a tour, which was what I was after. And we set up a tour for the next day during my lunch break. And I was so excited to be there. I was in the lobby and looking at the list of the benefactors, and I felt like, you know, this is kind of my son's final resting place in a way, and we are also contributors to this organization, and I felt a connection with all the people who had a history of this organization. I was able to meet Dr. James Ziske, who explained that he's one of the people that requests corneal tissue for the lab, and he's likely one of the people or the person that requested my son's tissue. And he was also caught off guard. He said, I've never met someone like you before. You know, what questions do you have for me? And I said, how do you order corneas? I'm like, do they come in the mail? Like, how does this even work? And he said, yes, there is an organization called the National Disease Research Interchange. Has anyone here ever used NDRI before to request human tissue? Okay. You can request diseased or healthy tissue from a variety of diseases to compare, and it will tell you the cause of death, the age, and all types of information about the tissue and when you request it. And he said it does arrive FedEx, and it's packed in ice and this kind of thing, and it arrives over here. And I said, how many corneas do you request in a year? Is it like one or two? Is it thousands? Are my son's corneas just kind of sitting in a pile collecting dust, or were they used right away? And he said, my lab requests about 10 pairs a year, and we would request more if we could, but they're hard to get. And he said, infant corneas are like gold to us. And that took my breath away. And I said, could you tell me why? And he said, because, first of all, their potential to regenerate in the media, in the lab, because infant cells regenerate a lot more than older people cells, and most of the corneas that they get are from older people, because most of us are older when we die, that these infant cells are extremely valuable. And he said, if you don't mind me asking, how long ago did your son die? And I told him about 2 years ago. And he said, we're likely still studying your son's eye cells in our lab right now. So it was so moving for me to hear this. I felt that this donation really was worthwhile. And he and my tour guide said, you know, we're never going to forget you, and we want you to keep in touch with us, which I've done. I even got a nice email from Dr. Ziske just saying, thank you for stopping by, and thank you for reminding him of where this tissue comes from. You know, it's not just an office supply. He also shared with me a study that was likely published with the use of my son's cells. Now, it's anonymous, it's de-identified, everything like that, but the fact that it's so rare, and he knew what day my son died and what day that this study came out, he said, this is likely the study that is a result of your son's eye cells. And those pictures, those colorful pictures, are likely pictures of Thomas's eye cells under a microscope. And what's even better about this, is so what they did in this study, essentially, is they took donated human umbilical cord blood, and they mixed it with Thomas's eye cells that they sort of wounded to see if the stem cells from the umbilical cord blood would help these corneal cells grow back, because there's a certain layer of corneal cells that once you lose them, they never come back and you start going blind. But they're trying to see if they can essentially do stem cell eye drops that would stop you from needing a corneal transplant, which is like stitches in your eye, which, as Calvin will tell you, it's not fun to get things stabbed in your eye. So I would rather have eye drops than a corneal transplant, and this is the idea. And they did find that there is potential for these cells to grow back with stem cells. And this study has since been cited in 21 more studies when I go to PubMed, as we talked about earlier in the conference. So a lot of people, and we do this too, when we want to feel the presence of our loved ones, you know, we'll visit the grave. But I can also Google this study and look it up and count how many citations that there have been. And it gives me this feeling that my son is still contributing. So this was such a valuable visit for me that I planned more visits. So I wanted to visit Duke and CytoNet and Penn. And luckily, and I called WRTC and I told them, you're never going to believe what I just did. I visited the lab at Harvard, and they were like, what? Oh my God. Like, were they nice to you? Like, these people are not trained to meet you. And they were afraid, like, they might not be that nice, and they're, you know, they're researchers. Maybe they're like robots. And I was like, they were actually really kind and compassionate, and it was a great visit. And that helped them set up more visits for me, because then it had been done once successfully before. I set up this visit to Duke by myself because we had sent the cord blood independently of WRTC, and I got to meet Simon Gregory, who worked on the Human Genome Project, and have a tour of the lab. I got to see where the FedEx envelope would have arrived with the blood in it, and I got to see the many, many freezers of blood, and they call it their sacred place because it's all kinds of blood from these babies that were deceased that are, you know, give their blood for the study. And I even got to talk to the graduate student who spent the most time with the twins' blood and studied it the most. And I said to her, did you learn anything surprising? And she said something that actually Larry Hunter said to me at lunch yesterday, which was, we're just at the beginning of learning this and we're just scratching the surface. And for me to be surprised, that implies that I knew what to expect, which I didn't. So we're just establishing a baseline of what to learn here. But she said, they studied the twins' cord blood, and they did confirm they were identical twins with identical genetics. and it had something to do with epigenetics, maybe something inherited, but they still don't really know. But they were glad to have the cord blood, and they even 4 years later were putting it in the front page of their newspaper, their newsletter, that they received a cord blood donation like this. So the researchers, you know, gave us a hug and thanked us for the donation. And we bought Duke t-shirts at that point. Oh, I forgot to mention I bought Harvard t-shirts at the last visit. So we bought Duke t-shirts, and then we visited Cytonet. At Cytonet, so Cytonet is a place that will take a donated human liver. They take the health, they get offered 200 livers a month, and they only take the healthiest 8, so it's people who are not overweight or drink a lot of alcohol. Maybe Mormons, I'm not really sure. But healthy people, you know. And they accepted my son's liver, and they essentially take a healthy liver and they apply an enzyme which breaks down the kind of glue that holds the hepatic cells together. So at the end you get like a pile of hepatic cells, and these cells are injected into a baby that's waiting on a liver transplant where if there's not a liver available or they need to grow to get a bit stronger, they call it a bridge therapy. So it's kind of like a transplant. I learned that my son's liver had some bruising on it when it arrived, which I guess is not uncommon in a neonatal liver because sometimes he was a little bit premature and sometimes the veins and arteries are not fully developed, and when they go to flush out the blood, it can get trapped and cause a bruise. So what they did was they used his liver in a 6-liver study to determine the best temperature to freeze infant liver cells to help save these babies. We got to meet the woman, Sonia, who actually held Thomas's liver in her hands. And we got to see some liver cells under a microscope. I got to look more closely at the outcome letter that said how many billions of cells that they received and how grateful they were. We got a tour of the facility, and Callum got a little, we had to wear kind of a sterile clean room outfit to take a tour. And Callum got to keep his, which he actually wore to the March for Science this year in Washington, D.C. And I can tell you, it was raining that day, and it was a very waterproof jacket. So after this visit, I started doing a bit of media interviews about this. And I didn't realize at the time that I may be one of the only people that's ever done this before. So I started doing interviews, and I got a new job in the field at the American Association of Tissue Banks. And when I first started, my CEO and I drove down to Richmond to visit Donate Life America's headquarters, and we stopped by Old Dominion Eye Foundation, which is the organization that recovered and processed my son's corneas and retinas. And I had some of the paperwork from the donation, and it was signed by a woman named Jennifer Payton. So I asked, you know, does Jennifer Payton still work here? And they said, yes, she does. You know, would you like to meet her? So I got to meet her and go back in her lab and see the shelf where Thomas's corneas and retinas would have been on, and seen the whole process of how that works and how they count the corneal cells on the microscope. And we had a lovely lunch together. And they even gave me an heirloom for Callum's file, which is the FedEx envelope that sent Thomas's corneas from, I guess it was Fairfax or Richmond, to Boston, to Harvard. So this is like a military medal or a wedding certificate to us. This shows Thomas's contribution. I also visited another conference, the Organ Procurement Conference, and I got to meet the people that work at NDRI. So it's kind of like match.com for scientists and tissue. So you log in what kind of tissue you need to do your study, and it will tell you if it's available, or they'll place it on back order, essentially. And there had been a backorder situation for my son's tissue. And this is what it looks like when you would like to order tissue or request tissue. And this is the same system that it would have looked like when they requested my son's corneas. So we had one final tissue to look into, and that was the retinas, the back of the eye. And this time I tried it a different way, and I wrote a letter to the researcher. I just said, dear researcher, can you tell me why you requested infant retinas in March of 2010? And I gave her a little bit of background about I've visited these other facilities, it's been very rewarding, and we would love to visit your facility if you're open to that. And 2 days later, I received a letter from her Dr. Arupa Ganguly of University of Pennsylvania, and she explained that she was studying retinoblastoma, which is a deadly cancer of the retina that affects children under the age of 5. And she said that, yes, we were welcome. So, and then she also sent a t-shirt to Callum. We spoke on the phone, and it was one of the most meaningful phone conversations of my life. She said initially, you know, your son gave the ultimate sacrifice. I don't know what to tell you. I don't know what to say, but, you know, thank you seems not enough. And I said, you know, Arupa, you seem like you feel like you owe something to me, and you don't. Contributing to your study has added a layer of meaning to our son's life, and you're the only person that wanted his retina. So if you didn't request these, they would be in the ground, not helping anyone, so I don't want you to feel guilty at all. You know, we needed you just as much as you needed us. We agreed to tour the lab on the twins' 5th birthday, which was March 23rd of 2010. And we got to meet the lab staff. And Arupa mentioned to me, she showed me some results. So she mentioned, just like Henrietta Lacks had a code name of HeLa, Thomas had a code name of RES360. So that means he was a research donor, and he was the 360th over the course of about 10 years. And she showed me some results based on RES360. And she explained to me that she had been waiting 6 years for this tissue, and her research was essentially on hold until this tissue could arrive. So even though he didn't have retinoblastoma, she had received a lot of donated tissue from children with retinoblastoma, but she needed some healthy tissue without retinoblastoma to compare. And it's so unusual to get this that she had waited 6 years. She also explained that the tissue was so valuable that she still had some. And this was 5 years later, but it was, you know, in vials. And she asked me if I would like to see the vials that she had left. And I said yes. And so she opened the freezer, and she showed us. It said RES360 on it. And it was so moving to see the end of the journey, you know. And afterwards, we had lunch together in the conference room. And they gave Callum a birthday gift, which was a little child's lab kit with like beakers and goggles, and they offered him an internship. So we've actually developed quite a nice friendship with Arupa, and we stay in touch over the years, and she sends Callum birthday gifts and Christmas gifts, and we actually have a new baby girl too that we just had a little over, almost 2 years ago, Jocelyn, and I was able to donate her placenta, and I tracked that down too, that's another story. But this journey was so validating, and the way I see it is that Thomas got into Duke, Penn, and Harvard. You know, not a lot of moms can say that, you know. And he has a job, and he has coworkers and colleagues who need him in order to do their job. They literally can't do their job without his donation. And he's relevant in this community. So I can't guarantee that everyone who donates to research will have this experience, but I do feel obligated to share this experience and just let you know that they didn't know I was coming. And I didn't see anything shady, and I do feel really glad that I made this donation. If there's anyone that's not here that you think should hear this story, I was able to do a TED talk about it. It was on Radiolab, if it sounds familiar. I know probably a lot of you listen to Radiolab, and it was called Gray's Donation. And I also published a book called A Life Everlasting that came out a couple years ago, and it's in the lobby for sale. So please feel free to share this with your friends and colleagues who aren't here. And at this time, I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Questions? People in the back, middle.
I'm an ultrasound technologist, so I've seen plenty of anencephalies, and so it's gratifying hearing the backstory because I just always doing the diagnosing. But what I wondered is if there were any, did they do any tests since these were identical twins of Callum afterwards to compare, and if there's any more that you know about how this happened. It was an environmental thing, actually, identical twins, but within, can you elucidate any more about how this happened to him and not to Callum?
No. And I did have some questions, but I don't think, I mean, the doctor was just like, Callum's fine. And even the paper that was based on their cord blood, it's not that conclusive. So I've had to just make my peace with the fact that I don't know, I may never know, and sometimes shit happens.
You should feel free not to answer this either, but I mean, so I know a lot of parents who had a child die, and I wonder if you would tell us a little bit about the experience of your daughter's birth and what was going on in your head.
Sure. When I had my daughter, it was a totally different feeling with the pregnancy because, of course, every time we went for the sonogram, we were expecting bad news, and we really didn't let ourselves feel happy until she was born and we heard the cry. And also, like, my husband and I lost a bet when it came to naming her. We made a bet that, like, I would name the boys and he would name the girls. And so he picked her name, which I didn't really like, but I was stuck with it because I lost the bet. Her name is Jocelyn, which it's okay. But I had friends say, like, I can't believe you're letting him name the baby and you don't even like the name. And I was like, you know what? She has a skull. Like, that's all I really care about. So there was a bit of shift in perspective.
Was there a question?
Thank you so much for sharing. And I was wondering, your sharing seemed really from your perspective, and I was wondering how you shared that with your husband. The journeys, the visits,
oh, right.
The tours.
Okay. So the first one, I did it on my own. Actually, my mom was there. She's here today, too. My mom happened to go with me on the business trip just for fun. So when I was able to hook this tour up, she came along. So I called Ross, and I was like, you're not going to believe where I was. This is so moving. This is amazing. And Ross's grief is coming at it from a different perspective. He was like, I don't really care about seeing a lab. It's not bringing him back to life. Like, I don't really care, which that's his right to be. But then when I did the other tours, I invited him to come along, and he did come. But I had to sort of convince him. I had to convince him for other reasons. Like, he's into sports, and I was like, we can do a stadium tour also. And so then he's like, okay, I'll go. But he was just not as into it as I was. And I'm like, this is amazing. He's like, well, it's a lab. What did you expect? And he's not as into it as I am, but he sort of humored me.
So first of all, Sarah, I have to applaud your bravery. I think the day you decided you were going to call them up and go to Harvard to see was an incredibly strong moment, and you're a brave person. But one of the things that concerns me in the world is that people don't participate in research, mm-hmm. which really could, it, increasing participation in clinical trials and a wide variety of different things could really help. And we don't have very good ways to increase participation. And it seems to me that your story, it's not going to motivate everyone, right. Your husband say, but it could motivate a lot of people. And I think we almost have a duty to participate in research to the degree that we can. So can you talk a little bit about how your story has been received by the public? And have you heard from people who felt validated or inclined to participate more in research because of your story?
Yes, that reminds me of a story. I got an email after the Radiolab story came out. There was a family in California, a couple, and they were expecting twins. And unfortunately, one of them died at birth. And they said to their local organ procurement organization, can we donate our daughter's body? And they said, no, she's not big enough. And they said, well, we heard on Radiolab about a baby that did donate for research. And the organ procurement group went back and said, you know what, you're right. You can donate 8 things. But they almost said no, but because of Radiolab, and so I, it's giving me a chill right now, but so I emailed Arupa, and I just said, Arupa, I wanna say thank you for letting me tour your lab, because if you didn't do that, and if you didn't open yourself up for that, I wouldn't have been able to tell the story, and it wouldn't have been on Radiolab, and it wouldn't have happened. And I said, also, this family donated their child's retinas. They gave me a list. And Arupa said to me, I know, because she got the retinas. And it was 6 years to the day that she received Thomas's. So she had been waiting 6 years and she got his, but then telling the story helped her get another pair. And to tell you the truth, that was kind of on my heart, is like, I want to tell the story enough that she gets another sample. I just didn't think it would happen that fast. So I have received emails from people, old and young. I've even had people who are like, I'm dying of cancer. I want to donate my tumor. I want to donate my body. How do I do that? And I've helped connect them with other people. But I agree that this needs to be shared. And I'm not the only one. And I'd like to help kind of show that I'm not the only one. There's a lot of us out there who are doing this, and make it okay to connect with the researchers. There's a lot of like, oh, there's HIPAA, there's confidentiality, there's this, there's that. But I found that when I met the researchers, they were sort of longing to meet me too. So please share the story, tweet it, do whatever you want to do with it so that it reverberates.
In the middle.
I was just curious how you are talking about this to your son, Callum.
It's so hard. So death is like a taboo topic, right? There's like stigma around it, and kids are not supposed to know about it, and if you tell them about it, you're harming them. And so I've been pretty honest with him about it from day one, just because I couldn't spin a web of lies forever. Like, I had to just be honest. So from the beginning, we had pictures of them together, and he knows that he had a twin, and his twin died because he had a very, very bad boo-boo on his head, not the kind of boo-boo that you just get by accidentally falling. So he's 8 now, and he has asking, I think, a bit more like age-appropriate questions about it. So I'm just as honest as I can. I have found that other people are uncomfortable with that, and I have to just let it go. Like, I've had one of his school counselors asked him, do you have any brothers or sisters? Like, they were sitting together on a bus. And he said, well, I did have a brother, but he died. And she got really upset by that. And it's true. Like, I would be upset if it wasn't true and he was saying that. But he's telling the truth. And so she, like, set up a meeting with me. Like, I need to talk to you. This is a big deal. And so she said, like, you know, he knows too much. And so it sort of spun out of control. But I've had more issues dealing with the adults than with him. But I don't know that I'm doing everything right. In fact, there was a time when I really felt like I screwed up, because we were reading this medical book. It was like a kid's medical book. And one of the things is like, A is for allergy, B is for bladder, like L is for liver. And I said, oh, you know, your brother like donated his liver and he's like a hero. And Callum was like, the doctor will take my liver? Like, I don't want to go to the doctor. And So I had to dial it back. But I'm learning, you know, I make mistakes too.
Other questions? Yeah, Sarah.
I'm notorious for making comments instead of questions, but I'll keep it short. Full disclosure, I'm a developmental psychologist. So I was gonna tell you that in my field, we hope for good enough parenting. And Sarah, I gotta say, I think you're knocking that one out of the park.
Thank you. Thank I gotta you. Sit next to you at lunch. All right. Thank you.
One more question right in the middle, and then I think that will be it for the.
Hi, this is more of a comment than a question, because I was going to say almost the same thing, that I have twin niece and nephew, and I do believe they remember somewhere in their brain that they were together. So I think telling your son from the beginning answered a mystery, and it made him whole.
Well, I feel like it's part of his identity also. Like, I don't want to take that away from him.
Right, right. But he needed to know. My mother lost a son before me, and I didn't know until I was an adolescent. And I was furious, just furious. Because he was a sibling.
I'm sure she was doing the best that she could, but she just didn't know what to say, right? But thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for pulling back that curtain. Thanks for attending. We'll hand it off to Larry.